100% jazz oriented. They're jazz rock oriented, the fusion, the Chicago's, the blood, sweat, and tears, the groups that are acceptable in the jazz idiom, but they're more akin to playing in 2D passages or harmonized things as opposed to improvisation. So it's just hard to say. We're in another era right now, and I think we'll tend to swing back to the purity of putting rock in one place and jazz in another place, but who's to say?
And of course, your school, University of Miami School of Music, has been and is in the vanguard, the forefront of new education. I think most people know, in case somebody there doesn't, the jazz band, the jazz studies department at your university has been rated the best now for a number of years. What, as the dean, what really are you trying to do with the school? What place are you trying to function in music?
Well, as you know, we have the largest school of music in a private university in the United States, and we compete with the other privates such as Eastman, Peabody, Juilliard, Manhattan, New England, Northwestern, USC.
Indiana.
Indiana is a public, of course, but we do compete with Indiana very favorably. Principally because we are a private university and we can take or reject students, whereas the state school many times has to take students because of the political pressure and so forth. Our goal really is to build, have a very solid traditional academic program in music, which we have in terms of music literature, theory composition, applied music, and music education. We're also attempting to fuse music with other subjects to have interdisciplinary programs, such as music therapy, when you mix music with medicine, nursing, that kind of thing. Music engineering, which is preparing audio engineers. That's music and electrical engineering. The business of music, music merchandising, we call it, where a student takes music and courses in the business school.
Really? What is responsible for the boom in music today among young people? I remember as a young man playing, struggling to play trumpet. There wasn't the huge nationwide interest, it didn't seem to me, that there is today in young people in music. Can you see a sociological reason for that?
There seems to have been a turnabout in the late 60s with the Kent State, the Vietnam, the rebellion of young people against physical things, against scientific things, a change over to the arts. People became more interested, for instance, in formal dance, in painting, in sculpturing, in performance of all kinds, in ways to be self-expressive that would not be harmful to other people. And I think we're seeing the apex of this interest right now. And it may be that we'll see more and more interest in the arts. It may be that, that people who are going into the humanities or into the sciences are going to at least take a taste of the arts along the way. I think we've come to realize that that the arts present really the stability of a certain era and a certain society. And without the attention to creativity and allowing people the ability to express themselves, you stifle that creativity and it causes all kinds of emotional problems.
We're almost in a renaissance of the 20th century, aren't we?
Yes, we are.
Well, it's
an exciting time to be here.
Well, it's good to have people like you in charge of music schools. Let's show again this book, which I guess is the book on Stan Kenton. Everything you've ever wanted to know about Stan and didn't know enough to ask or care. It's available in bookstores in the University of Miami and in Dalton bookstores. And we're going to close now. I'm going to you're going to hear some music and you're going to see some pictures of an album that Johnny Richards wrote for Stan Kenton in the early 50s called Cuban Fire. I first heard it as a young man and never realized when I heard it and loved it that I would be living in Miami, which has become Cuba of its own. And so I think as you'll see the pictures of the people of our Latin section and hear the music of Johnny Richards and Stan Kenton, Cuban Fire, you'll have some understanding of what a giant Mr. Kenton was. Billy, we're going to watch and listen to some music, and thank you very much.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it very much.
Now here's Stan Kenton.
American, and there's no federal official going to stand up and tell me, we don't care what you think, because we're the American people, and we pay the money, we pay the taxes, and we support these people, and we're fed up.
I can't get a job because I don't speak Spanish. They complain about the damn unemployment rate, and yet we're bringing people over here, giving them the damn jobs because they speak Spanish. I live in Hialeah. I feel like one of the only Anglos left there.
Because let's face it, we're going to live here for quite some time. And we've just got to start working together, and that's Spanish-speaking, non-Spanish-speaking, blacks, Jews, and any other group in this county. We really have to start working together because we've got some very serious problems in this community.